and it really wouldn't, they understood it in terms of being a physical setting which could expand along a spectrum of scale. So you've got, kind of got a room, a house, a city, a countryside, a nation, the world, the universe kind of thing. For the ecology groups, on the other hand, environment meant a pressing political issue, the need to protect the Earth's natural resources, and, you know, against from further destruction at the hands of the dominant political, economic, and with those, they saw design interests. So as Ecology Action founder Cliff Humphrey said in his main stage lecture, quote, "What we are talking about then is manifesting by design a survival gap, between the people on this planet and the ability of the life support system to support these people." And there were lots of sort of odd diagrams like this one wielded in service of this argument. He also made a kind of almost like a three-dimensional diagram on stage using garbage gathered from the conference, and there again we see that image of the Earth that had been on the whole Earth catalogue from 1969. And he continued by saying, this is still Clifford Humphrey, saying, "You know, if our youth can say hell no to the draft, then I think that a few of you have to learn to say hell no to some salesmen and to some developers. If an item is made to be wasted, to be dumped on a dump, then don't make it." End quote. The ecology groups also, as well as their main stage speeches and the way they got the content in that way, they were also initiating numerous interventions during the week. There was one where they made everyone change, sort of stand up and pass their name badge to the next person, and so on and so on, and then embark on a process of relocating themselves. A little clunky as an exercise in interaction, but quite interesting that while the attendees were exchanging cards, the audience members really were talking to each other. They made handmade signs in the search for their name badges. And the instigators paced about on the stage with handheld microphones, rationalizing the exercise as a demonstration of the attendees' interdependence as part of an ecological chain. And this was a phrase from Cliff Humphrey's militant manifesto, the Unanimous Declaration of Interdependence, obviously a little subversion of Jefferson's Declaration of Independence. It declared that, quote, "All species are interdependent, and whenever any behavior by members of one species becomes destructive to these principles, it is the function of other members of that species to alter or abolish it, such behavior, and to reestablish the theme of interdependence with all life." End quote. In between the speaker presentations, attendees would gather in small groups, sit down on the floor, discuss, you know. And the conference board members really made attempts to kind of engage in these conversations, even sitting down on the floor with them. But it was clear that the two groups had had great difficulty communicating with one another. Not only did they look different, they didn't even share the same basic vocabulary. There was a paper often circulated at the conference titled How to Attend a Conference, which articulated the gentlemanly code of conduct required from both speaker and listener at a conference in order to reach consensus. It portrayed the conference as a situation in which ideas are exchanged and personal viewpoints are enriched through the challenge provided by the viewpoints of others. Discussion is stalemated, wrote the author of the paper, by what he called terminological tangle, or the conflicting definition of key terms. And as if in illustration of this predicament, there was some particularly heated conversations between board members, including Elliot Noyes, we see here in the middle looking very befuddled, and members of the moving company theatre troupe, one of whom had to explain the then new term hype to confused noise. Subsequently, the conversation between another crisp-looking man and the long-haired leader of the moving company broke down completely. They leaned in and jabbed their index fingers at one another as they became visibly frustrated with their inability to find any shared points of reference. The man said, "So you're saying that I have to understand what you're telling me today? I don't understand it." And the actor from the moving company troupe says, we were saying that everything is a ripoff. Everyone is stealing. The entire civilization is based on the wrong premises. Dig that. We are living in the wrong reality. And the man says, well, tell me what the right civilization is. And the moving company guy says, I can't talk to you if you say that, because you're already saying that you're alienated. End quote. Typical conversations from the conference. And then in another one, poor Saul Bass was sitting down trying to understand. And he says, you know, why do we have to assess capitalism? We're just trying to stage a design conference. A young, intense-looking individual attempted to explain, unless you actually live the lifestyle, it's just bullshit. In the board meeting after the conference, Bass reflected, quote, this time the design problem is ourselves. That's why I'm so shook up about this whole thing. So the French group's contribution to the conference was a statement of refusal, unsurprisingly, written by Baudrillard and read aloud. So in their view, they didn't want to participate. There was a complicity of silence hanging over the meeting. And Baudrillard rejected the gathering interest in environmental issues as an opiate concocted by the capitalist system to unify a disintegrating society. He posited that both the conference theme and the populist crusade currently preoccupying the nation simply diverted attention and energy toward a Boy Scout idealism, as he called it, with a naive euphoria in a hygienic nature, and away from the real social and political problems of the day, such as class discrimination, civil rights, the Vietnam War, and any other issues that happened to be going on in the 70s. The new focus on pollution, Baudrillard pointed out, was not merely about protecting flora and fauna, but about the establishment seeking to protect itself from the polluting influence of communism, immigration, and disorder. So environmentalism to Baudrillard, then, was a ruse of government to maintain the very economy that was threatening the environment. And he saw designers very much as implicated in this sort of this myth-making. Baudrillard found the physical setting of the conference to be fundamentally at odds with the seriousness of the issue at stake, referring to Aspen as, quote, the Disneyland of environment and design, and drawing attention to the fact that we're speaking about apocalypse in a magic ambience. So next up were the students who read aloud their resolutions, which they'd been concocting during the week, which called for, among other things, withdrawal of troops from Southeast Asia, an end to the draft, legalization of abortion, you know, all the usual design topics. But it was the final point of the document that was the most contentious. It asked that designers attending the conference, quote, refuse to create structures, advertisements, products, and develop ideas whose primary purpose is to sell materials for the sole purpose of creating profit. They added, this attitude is a destructive force in our society. This really struck at the core of the design profession as it was represented by the conference. It also pointed to the contradiction in the conference's environmental theme being discussed and indeed sponsored by those deeply implicated through their day-to-day transactions in harming the environment. So just to give you a sense of the corporate contributors for the conference, all the goodies, Coca-Cola, Ford, IBM, Mobil Oil, not exactly known for their resource-light manufacturing and distribution processes. So the question of how to engage with and how to resist the liberal establishment preoccupied these earnest and impassioned students at the Aspen Conference, just as it did students more generally in the late 1960s and early 70s. It was clear, however, that new forms of resistance were necessary. Criticism up till now has sort of been mostly conceived of as a written activity, something that you find within the sort of edited and framed within the pages of magazines. Well, that sort of genre, that type of criticism no longer seemed sufficient for the scale of the problems that the students wanted to attack. The report of a student meeting at the conference records. Finally, one student in anger said, "You can't write a letter to a vending machine. You have to kick it." End quote. So, the week is coming to a close, and the board decide to have a, you know, have their meeting to debrief. In a discussion between Noyes and Bass, we can see here before the board meeting began, Noyes appeared bemused and upset. He scratched his arms and his eyes wandered as he attempted to make sense of the palpable change in the conference atmosphere. "All those resolutions at the end had nothing to do with the subject of the conference," he said. "This is the politicizing, I believe that's the word, of the Aspen Design Conference. I'm interested in making my points through my work, and I'm not a political guy. It's not in me." End quote. The discussion returned repeatedly to the failures of the conference format, and toward the end of the 3.5-hour meeting, Noyes, who stated that the conference had left him, quote, "battered, bruised, stale, and weary," resigned his presidency of the conference, a position he'd held for 5 years. You could say, to paraphrase Charles Jenks, that design criticism died at 1:47 p.m., on Saturday, June 20th, 1970, or thereabouts. And yet, the IDCA did not implode or even reversibly redirect its course. It absorbed the critiques leveled against it and appropriated some of the new formats. It inserted a new space in the program for conference feedback and started calling speakers resource people. But eventually it returned to a lecture-based structure with a bias towards celebrity designers and set a cap on the number of student attendees to prevent future trouble. So as the liberal design establishment folded the conflict of the conference back into its thick blanket of consensus, the protesters and their various missions dispersed like cotton balls in the wind. Some became the celebrity designers of future conferences, and many founded their own institutions. The protests that materialized at that conference epitomized more widespread counterculture protests during the late 60s and 70s. And in terms of design discourse, the Aspen moment connected with broader challenges to modernist orthodoxies represented by the work of Italian radical design and architecture collectives such as Superstudio and UFO. So the critique which was directed at the conference may have atomized, but the methods and means of its enactment would reemerge throughout the latter part of the 20th century as the purposes, publics, and poetics of the written variant of design criticism became increasingly contested. For the most part, written design criticism of the period, as I was just mentioning before, was tended to be a one-way communication. Critics could gauge response to their articles only very indirectly through letters published in subsequent issues of magazines, right? This is before blog comments. Mostly, their criticism was uttered into a silent void. With the criticism at the conference, the kind of physical, embodied type of criticism, the situation was different. The protesters were able to confront their targets in person and could register the effects in real time. The protest that punctured the conference was made up of numerous non-written ephemeral elements, corridor discussions, Q&A sessions, attire or the lack of it, body language and gestures, theatrical performances, inflatable structures, parties and picnics, objects and graphic ephemera. In combination, I think they represent a form of criticism as a spontaneous and performative event that was using countercultural activist tactics as what was called a style of action. This is Ant Farm's marijuana currency. So this makes the events of the IDCA 1970, I think, a particularly illuminating case study of a disruption to a paradigm shift in the established practice and role of design criticism in the post-war era. So now it's time. That's, I wanted to give that case study to kind of to show where a lot of my ideas about design criticism come from, but now it's time to zoom out and fast forward and bring things up to date. The maps were changing. It's a bit fuzzy, but it's the Ant Farms truck stop network map. The grids were shifting. As we can see here in Super Studio's application of a grid to the landscape, they were playing with that, with the interface between natural and artificial environments, believing that the grid would allow for a truly democratic human experience because every point on the grid is identical, no place better than any other. Their anti-architectural proposals offered a utopic vision of a world undesigned. The touch point for this warped worldview was the gradual rise of ecology as a movement, I think. So we've got the establishment of the Environmental Protection Agency, the US Clean Air Act, Clean Water Act, and Endangered Species Act. That all happened between 1970 and 1973, albeit just in the US, but it shows the kind of the speed at which the movement was kind of picking up. And really, like I said before, it was to do with the emergence and the the cementing really of this image in the public consciousness. Earthrise is possibly the most iconic portrait of the planet, captured by Apollo 8, the first crewed lunar mission in 1968. This one, which became known as the Blue Marble shot, was shot by the crew of Apollo 17 in 1972 and really was instrumental in fueling further environmental activism. What was so special about this image in particular was that the photograph captured the Earth with the sun behind the camera, illuminating most of the globe. And this is at a distance of 45,000 kilometers from the planet. Earlier this year, NASA released an amazing new image that shows the Earth and the Moon as seen from Mars. And that's 127 million miles away, captured by NASA's Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter. Unfortunately, though, the way the Earth sees itself now is less of a blue marble and more of an artificial light show. Or inconvenient distance between corporate board meetings to be crisscrossed by flight paths. There are more than 100,000 flights per day at the moment. Or this visualization, which shows the quantity of space junk in our orbit. On the moon alone, I love this list, there are 200 tons of man-made trash, including such bizarrely banal objects as golf balls, boots, cameras, rakes and shovels, used wet wipes, and empty packages of space food. This list is symbolic of a sad legacy of our era of mass production, in which designed goods have been made in larger and larger numbers to provide the illusion of choice, and they've been made to last for less time to provide the illusion of progress. But there are many other images that conjure our current condition in stark relief. And this one sticks in my mind particularly. It's one of the many hundreds of crabs that now make their homes out of plastic debris, washed up on Henderson Island in the Pitcairn Island group, an uninhabited island in the South Pacific, and one of the world's last two remaining raised coral atolls and a UNESCO heritage site. But unfortunately, where there are now 38 million items of debris, which is the highest density of plastic rubbish anywhere in the world. And you'll note that this particular crab has chosen an Avon cosmetics jar for its home. So last year, a working group of stratigraphic scientists submitted a recommendation to the International Geological Congress that we are actually now in a new geological epoch, the Anthropocene, or the New Age of Man, as it's kind of defined. The epoch is thought to have begun in the 1950s, when human activity, namely rapid industrialization, nuclear activity, set global systems on a new trajectory. And there's evidence in the geographic record Indeed, scientists say that nuclear bomb testing, industrial agriculture, human-caused global warming, which we'll bracket design within, I think, and the proliferation of plastic across the globe has so profoundly altered the planet that it is time to declare the 11,700-year Holocene, which was a period of relatively stable climatic conditions. That period, according to these scientists, is over. The detritus of our design solutions have, to quote their report, quote, left an array of signals in recent strata, including plastic, aluminum, concrete particles, artificial radionuclides, changes to carbon and nitrogen isotype patterns, fly ash particles, and a variety of fossilizable biological remains, including that of the domesticated chicken, which I didn't realize, but has become the world's most common bird and has been fossilized in thousands of landfill sites and on street corners around the world. So this is what we're going to be leaving as a permanent record in the Earth strata, which is, yeah, pretty depressing. So 21st century design, I think, faces a dilemma, and that's best summed up, don't worry, I'll sum the book up for you, the French philosopher and sociologist Bruno Latour, who presents us with the ultimatum. Between modernizing and ecologizing, we have to choose. And to give you a sense of the scale of the problem, the online retailer Amazon offers more than 480 million different products, for example. And each year, we, as a global population, produce 1.3 billion tons of municipal solid waste. Waste that, in English literature professor Brian Thill's conception, lays thick blankets of our chemical age across the entire planet, into every rocky outcropping, to the bottom of every sea's floor, nestling in the trees and bogs and pools of the world. It's in the air, in the water, in the yards, in the yard sales brimming with kitsch, in houses stuffed to the rafters with rubbish, in outer space, spreading out in invisible clouds of toxic chemicals and piling up in immense mountains of garbage stacked in trash picks below ground at Freshkills or Pointy Hills or 1,000 other dump sites. Sorry, it's getting a bit depressing, isn't it? But I do think that's an incredibly evocative summation of our situation, and in a way we can treat that, well, I treat that as an image just alongside those other ones. So when design is considered from this perspective as the waste it will become, then, as design theorist Ben Highmore has observed, quote, it's hard not to see global warming and climate change as a consequence of a variety of design processes, design values, and design products, end quote. See, the problem with design is that ever since mass production conferred value on the novel commodity, is that so much of our intellectual energy is expended on conceiving of it in its new box-fresh state. As the ever-proliferating meme of unboxing videos attests, I don't know if you've ever got lost in these, but I don't recommend it. So too often our engagement with design, and by that I mean as designers, as critics, as consumers, as everybody, tends to focus on only one moment in a designed object's life cycle. The moment when it's new, when it's suspended in a perpetual present, without attending to what happens to it after its period of usefulness is over and you throw it away. In general, I think the richer you are, the further your trash is taken away from you. But as Timothy Morton points out, there really is no away. When we discard all those things that just don't spark joy anymore, they still exist as matter in space, just someone else's space. And they still exist in time. Geobiologists such as Rienfeld Leinfelder stress the importance of discussing different conceptions of time, and that's in addition to human generational time, which is how we deal with most stuff in our life. So cosmic, evolutionary, you know, geological, cultural, technological, societal time. We need to bring that into the conversation. Ecological theorist Timothy Morton proposes the term hyperobject, and I really think this helps us to think of things in terms of their massive distribution in time relative to humans. For example, a hyperobject could be the very long-lasting product of direct human manufacture, such as styrofoam or plastic bags. Design so far, design studies, the world, you know, that I certainly operate in, hasn't developed a very rich discourse yet in this field, but it doesn't matter because there's loads of these other areas of thought which are developing really fast. There's discard studies, there's trash studies, there's branches of archaeology, social studies, environmental humanities, garbology, eco-criticism, right? There's all these areas that are working hard at this that we can kind of import from, I think. And it's, you know, it's beginning to happen within design too. We're beginning to attend to a expanded notion of timescale in relation to design. We have things now a little bit like in architecture where you have post-occupancy evaluation. With design now we're beginning to be attentive to, oh, I wonder what does happen after it leaves the store kind of thing. Product life cycle analysis and so forth. Such initiatives can be seen as recent manifestations of a lineage we can track back to the 1960s again, and I'll just quickly go through these. You know them well probably, but this work by journalist Vance Packard, who leveled pretty biting critiques against the advertising industry, which he held accountable for persuading people to buy things they didn't need, and at American manufacturers for their adoption of planned obsolescence as a business model and consumers for their excessive consumption, basically everyone. And the social designer Viktor Papanek, who famously proclaimed, there are professions more harmful than design, but not many. And when I wrote my book, I published earlier this year, I have to mention it, which is about the history of design criticism, I saw that a central theme in criticism since the 1950s has been design's proximity to the landfill, to that very, very fine line between that newness, that box freshness of design and its state as trash. And I was looking at the critic's role as gatekeeper of that landfill, the arbiter deciding what goes in as trash and what should be retrieved as treasure. For as Susan Strasser has noted, one of these many writers looking at the notion of trash, trash is a dynamic category. The status of goods is in constant flux. So I use the metaphor of sifting as to stand in for this idea of critical discernment, to analyze a range of critical output between 1950 and the early 2000s. And the Aspen moment that we, you know, discussed in detail earlier was pivotal, I think, in developing design's heightened engagement with the meanings and materiality of trash. Just to mention two others, though. Just an example of an exhibition that happened in 1983 in London at the Boiler House, which was the sort of embryonic version of the Design Museum as we know it today, but then was housed in the basement of the V&A Museum. And of course, here the curator Stephen Bailey was kind of signaling to us which, you know, items from the design canon he thought should be put into the trash, very literally on these upturned trash cans. And the ones he liked, he kind of rescued and put on the white pedestals, a very simplistic binary. But it sort of brought trash back into circulation, I suppose. And another example in the 1990s in London of a different kind of engagement with the trash can be found in this exhibition called Stealing Beauty. But by this point, designers were more interested in kind of recovering the aesthetic qualities of the detritus of the everyday, right? So the bus tickets, the the bits of old plywood, supermarket trolleys, this kind of thing, which they could confer with new status as design. Just to give you a couple of examples, the upturned pendant bucket light here we see in a kind of exaggeratedly decrepit kitchen scenario, very stylized setting for this kind of design. Another example here of the Azumi's chair made out of supermarket trolley material in a dismal London backyard. More recently in the work of critical designers, one can discern a more thoughtful, I think, engagement with the trash, really as the acknowledged destination of our design. And so among the various, because I mean, if you're a designer working today and you are confronted with that ultimatum from Bruno Latour, between modernizing and ecologizing, you have to choose. I mean,